गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, वी शैल बी कंटिन्यूइंग विद द इशू ऑफ रेस इन द नॉवल एंड एडिंग ऑन डिफरेंट पर्सपेक्टिव्स टू व्हाट वी हैव ऑलरेडी लर्न. सो लेट्स सी. हकलबेरी फिन, एज आई हैव मेंशन्ड बिफोर, हकलबेरी फिन डिड गो थ्रू अ लॉट ऑफ कॉन्ट्रोवर्सीज. The novel was a very controversial novel because of the themes that it was dealing with, and also because of the way it was dealing that theme, given the fact that it was set in the post-abolition America, in the Reconstruction era, and before the Reconstruction, that is, and since it dealt with characters of such wide complacency, and the way that it treated race with humor that was obviously offensive to great sections of the society, and it became all the more controversial as it was decided in the 20th century that Huck Finn was to be introduced, or Huck Finn was to be included in the school curricula, in the academic curricula. And as a result, it started off fresh accusations and fresh complaints about the novel and the story and the characters and the dialogue within the novel. So let's begin with the class then. Yes. What added to the complication regarding the novel was that Huck Finn's, or the novel's, entrenchment or inclusion in the English curricula of junior and senior high schools, it coincided with a legal case called Brown versus Topeka Board of Education, and the conclusion of this case being that the Supreme Court ended public school segregation legally, if not actually, in 1954. So public school segregation was ended. So desegregation and the civil rights movement therefore deposited or ended Huck in the midst of American literature classes, which were no longer composed and dominated by white children only. Now they were full of black youngsters as well. In the faces of these children and the children of the revolution, they were the children of revolution, right, who, as a result of the revolution, they were being included in the American classroom setting. And in the faces of these children of revolution, Huck met the group that was to become his most persistent and formidable foe, the people who most persistently opposed to the novel's inclusion in any sort of formal reading procedure. Lot of legal dealings or legal activities that were going around concerning the novel, whether or not it should be approved, or what abridgments or what changes should be made, how should the racist attitudes of the novel be toned down, etc., etc. I will be sending you a short note regarding the history of controversy that involves Huckleberry Finn. So I will be sending you a short note regarding the controversies that surround the legal controversies that had surrounded the novel while it was being decided whether or not it should be included in the academic curricula, etc., etc., which is of course a serious issue, and it's an interesting history to know. But since we do not have the luxury of time, I shall not be indulging in that. I do have another video posted on YouTube, and that I had recorded for the last semester or the last time I taught Huckleberry Finn in the college. So I can share that link, and it's in that video. It's I have dealt with the issue of race in more details within the class, that is. So if you want to avail yourself of that, it's available in the same YouTube channel that I have for all my recorded lessons. So you can just go ahead and take a look through that video. That will be addressed in much more details. However, It does not mean that I am excluding important things from my lectures right now. What I am doing is that basically it's increasing your work. I'm supporting, I will be providing you with more materials so that you can study bits and pieces by yourself as well. So any which way, let's move on. As I was saying, I will be supporting you with a note which deals in details with the legal controversies that surrounded the novel while it was being decided whether or not it should be included within the academic curricula. But the major point of discontent, the major point of controversy regarding the novel was the use of the word nigger, the language of the novel that came under serious scrutiny, that came under serious attack. The book was called, you know, racist trash. It was said that the book legitimized the use of the word nigger, and if it was admitted in the academic curricula, that legitimization would also occur within public schools as well, and thereby affecting the adolescent psychology. These were the major accusations. And these accusations ranged throughout the country. And added to this controversy was that the novel was considered, on the other hand, as an American classic. So an American classic, or a classic of any or literature that is, you know, elevated to the level of a national classic, it entails certain implications. It implies that this is the cultural representation of the entire nation. So if this book is admitted into such a category, does it also not imply that American culture is inherently racist, and that it authenticates and legitimizes uses of racial slurs, the word nigger being such a critical usage for the black community? So children, parents, legal activists, lawyers, etc., all of these people equally objected to the language of the novel. And there was even a letter that came out in the New York Times. I have quoted from the letter, and look at what this reader is saying. And he's saying that, "I can still recall the anger I felt as my white classmates read aloud the word nigger. In fact, as I write this letter, I'm getting angry all over again. I wanted to sink into my seat. Some of the whites snickered, others giggled." Then he says, "I would flip ahead. I only recall the sense of relief I felt when I would flip ahead a few pages and see that word nigger would not be read that hour." So this is what I was talking about. The presentation of the novel as an American classic serves as an official endorsement of a term uttered by the most prejudiced racial bigots, racial hypocrites, to an age group eager to experiment with any language of shock value. One reporter even went ahead and likened the teaching of the novel to 8th graders as pulling the pin of a hand grenade and tossing it into the all too common American classroom. So that was how dangerous the novel was. There were other perspectives as well. Of course, the culture of America being such heterogeneous, there are other perspectives. So some who have followed the novel, so racial problems, they express dismay that some blacks misunderstand the ironic function Twain assigned nigger, or that other blacks, in spite of their comprehension of the irony, they will allow themselves and their influence and their privilege to be defeated by a mere pejorative. So this was these people were saying, like Leslie Fidler, who says that you need to laugh. At the same time, you acknowledge your painful history. And the moment that you laugh, you do not deny it. But at the same point of time, you come to acquiescence with it and move beyond this fact, move beyond the peculiar institution of slavery. So this is quite a problematic statement that she makes, as we will see. And there were others who were even more defending the book and, you know, asking teachers and people and readers alike to cope with what the novel tries to do. So I will be sharing this particular essay, what the quote that you can see on your screen. I will be sharing one essay written by this person, Justin Kaplan, which essay is basically an appreciation of the novel, which is as important for you as a reader of the book or a scholar of literature to understand. So Justin Kaplan is an appreciator of the book, appreciator of the novel, who sees the novel as an intermingling of the multifarious culture through which America has grown, the culture which the earlier generations have created, the later generations have been bound to be a part of, and even later generations can observe the culture at a safe distance and at the same time recognize, acknowledge and appreciate the intermingling and the development of America as a nation. So I will be sharing this essay with you and therefore not talk about that much right now. But the problem lies in the fact that these people, the two examples that I gave, they erroneously, mistakenly suppose that nigger can be objectified so as to allow, the word nigger can be objectified so as to allow a black person to laugh therapeutically at slavery. It illustrates the incapacity of the whites or the non-blacks to understand, to comprehend the enormous emotional baggage that is attached to the hate word nigger for each black person. And therefore I quote Langston Hughes from one of his books, The Big Sea. It is an autobiography. It is his autobiography, and he offers this explanation for the signification of the word nigger to blacks. You can read it, what he's saying. The word nigger to colored people of high and low degree is like a red rag to a bull. Used rightly or wrongly, ironically or seriously, of necessity for the sake of realism, or impishly for the sake of comedy, does not matter. Negroes do not like it in any book or play whatsoever. Word nigger, you see, sums up for us who are colored all the bitter years of insult and struggle in America. Non-blacks know implicitly that to utter the word nigger in the presence of a Negro is to throw down a gauntlet that will be kept and taken up with a vengeance. And to dismiss the word's recurrence in the novel again and again as an accurate rendition of the 19th century American linguistic conventions. So you can dismiss it because you can say that this was a linguistic convention, and for the sake of realism, it had to be maintained. So this denies what every black person knows. Far more than a synonym for slave, nigger signifies a concept. It conjures up, it brings together, it reminds you centuries of specifically black degradation and humiliation, during which the family was disintegrated, the black family was disintegrated, education was denied, manhood was trapped within a forced perpetual slavery or puritanism, and womanhood was destroyed by the process of keeping concubines. Marriage was even not allowed. So if one allows that Twain substituted nigger for slave, the implications of the word do not improve at all. Nigger denotes the black man as a commodity, as a chattel, as a property that can be sold off, very much like properties can be sold off. So in addition to serving as a reminder of the peculiar institution that Fiedler was talking about, the word nigger encapsulates the decades of oppression that followed emancipation. It means not only racist terror and the lynch mobs, but that victims deserved it. It also alludes to the fact, it also makes you remember of the fact that there were lynch mobs, and there were murders, there were rapes. And accompanied with all of these events was a subconscious thought that the niggers deserved it. outside Central Park, Central High, in Little Rock in 1954 in America, the word nigger was emblazoned in huge placards all over the city. And across the South throughout the 1950s to the 60s. It was screamed by angry mobs, this word. Currently, it is the chief taunt of the Ku Klux Klan and other white supremacist groups. In short, nigger has the odious distinction of signifying all the shame, frustration, rage, and the fear that have been so much a part of history of race relations in the United States. And the blacks still consider it dirtier than any of the once taboo four-syllable Anglo-Saxon monosyllabic. All of those four-lettered cuss words that are now normalized. They were once taboo. But the blacks consider the word nigger worse or dirtier than any of those cuss words. So to impute blacks' hatred, to deny or to accept the hatred of the blacks for the word nigger as something that is hypersensitive or oversensitive on their part, it hinders, you know, it adds on to the, it condones the injustice with utter carelessness and callousness and signals a refusal to acknowledge that the connotations of that word generate a cultural discomfort that blacks share with no other racial group. And even if we try to counteract or, you know, debate this response that nigger triggers for many black readers, some scholars have striven to reveal the positive effects of the usage of these words. The positive function that the novel serves, that the word serves in the novel, by exposing the discrepancy between the dehumanizing effect of the word and the real humanity of Jim. So among these people is again Leslie Fiedler, who in an essay cites the passage in which Huck lies to Aunt Sally. You know, he's dressed as a girl and lies to Aunt Sally about a steamboat explosion that hurt no one but killed a nigger. And Aunt Sally callously responds, "Well, it's lucky, because sometimes people do get hurt." This statement in itself is a very antithetical statement, as you can see. And Fiedler notes that the passage brims with humor at the expense of Aunt Sally and the convention to which she conforms. But Fiedler is also of the opinion that Huck does not get the joke. He does not recognize the humor of the fact that he and Aunt Sally, by dehumanizing the Negro, diminish their own humanity. It seems that Huck's foes, Huck's enemies, it seems to Huck's enemies, that is those people who are seriously condemning the novel for its racist attitudes and portrayals. It seems to these people that if Huck does not get the joke, which is of course true, then there is no joke, because Huck is the protagonist. Huck is the receiver and giver of all the information of the entire story, of the entire narrative. So if he does not get the joke, there is no joke. And he becomes as culpable as Aunt Sally. However, this passage is particularly very important because racial objectives isolate it as one of the most visible and detrimental flaws of the novel. The highlighting of this passage, it can invite various perspectives. You can say that you have to be deliberately thick in order to avoid the humor which brims in this passage, and then on the other hand say or come to the opinion that such passages are evidence of Mark Twain's racism. There are other people who arrive at a conclusion, and their conclusion that is completely different from the view that I just provided. In order to believe in Twain's satirical intention, one has to believe in Huck's good faith towards Jim. That is to say, one has to believe, rather than reflecting his own adherence to such conventions. So you and I, we may not adhere to such conventions, such racial conventions. But I have to believe, you and I, we have to believe, rather than showing our adherence to such conventions, that Huck simply weaves a tale, he creates a tale that marks him as a right-thinking youngster. So this supporting of Huck's character and the attack that he gets, this support is based upon this one particular scene that I've been talking about that occurs in chapter 32. And that support is mostly based on the way that Huck deals with his crisis, with his quote-unquote crisis of conscience, less than 24 hours prior to his encounter with Aunt Sally. Now, there is no denying the rightness of Huck's decision to risk his soul for Jim, but there is no tangible or concrete reason to assume that the regard Huck acquires for Jim during his odyssey down the river Mississippi on the raft, it encompasses all blacks. Further, Huck's choice to go to hell, which he says, quote-unquote, to go to hell, has little to do with any respect that he has acquired for Jim as a human being with an inalienable right to be owned by no one. He does not acknowledge that. Rather, his personal affection for the slave governs his overthrow of societal mores. So it is his personal affection for the slave. It must be remembered that Huck does not judge slavery to be wrong. He selectively disregards a system. He selectively disregards wherever it is plausible for him, wherever it is impossible for him, wherever it is profitable, wherever it is at a loss. He selectively disregards the system, but a system which he eventually ultimately believes is right. So when he discourses with Aunt Sally, he is expressing views he still holds. His libertine attitudes, his emancipatory attitudes extend no further than his love for Jim only. It seems valid to argue then that were he given the option of freeing other slaves, Huck would not necessarily choose manumission. Manumission, which means the legal freeing of a slave, that is manumission. So Huck would not necessarily choose manumission if he was given a choice. Mark Twain's apparent perpetuation of racial stereotypes, which he does in the novel, he perpetuates the usage of racial stereotypes through his portrayal of Jim and other blacks in Huck Finn. It bears relation to his use of nigger and has fostered vociferous criticism from the anti-Huck Finn forces, from the anti-Huckleberry Finn forces. Like the concept nigger, Twain's depiction of blacks, particularly Jim, represents the tendency of the dominant white culture to put up blacks with traits that deny their humanity and mark them as inferior. Critics disparage scenes that depict blacks as childish, inherently less intelligent than the white man, superstitious beyond reason and common sense, and grossly ignorant of standard English. Further, they charge that in order to entertain the white audience, Twain relied upon the stock conventions of black minstrelsy. I will be sharing a couple of essays with you, one which is a longish dissertation and one particular chapter from a book which support this view. Yes, Twain relied upon the stock conventions of black minstrelsy, which drew upon European traditions of using the mask of blackness to mock individuals or social forces. Critics express their greatest displeasure with Twain's presentation of Jim, the runaway slave viewed by most as second only to Huck in importance to the novel's thematic structure. Although he is the catalyst that spurs Huck along his odyssey of conscience, Jim commences the novel and to some degree remains as the stereotypical superstitious quote-unquote darky that Twain's white audience would have expected and in which they would have delighted. in an essay by Ralph Ellison. Ellison examines the play Twain gives the minstrel figure. Though Twain does strike Jim in the mold of the minstrel tradition, Ellison believes that we observe Jim's dignity and human capacity emerge from behind the stereotype mask. Yet, by virtue of this minstrel mask, Jim's role as an adult is undercut, and he often appears more childlike than Huck. Though Ellison writes that it is not at all odd that this black-faced figure of white fun is for Negroes a symbol of everything they rejected in the white man's thinking about race, in themselves and in their own group. Though he says this, in his final analysis seems to be that Jim's humanity transcends the limits of the minstrel tradition. Now let us now shift to this portrayal of stereotypical portrayal or the minstrel show that is being spoken about, that I just spoke about. Now, Edward Windsor Kemble, he was a 20th century artist who was writing in the Life magazine. He was mostly a caricature artist, advertisement artist, who would later on work for Twain, Mark Twain, as someone who would be portraying the pictorial, portraying Huckleberry Finn in the pictorial presentation. He was known as this Kemble, Edward Windsor Kemble was known as a delineator of the South, the Negro being his specialty. Negro drawing was his specialty. By 1930, Kemble's specialty had carried him through a career of some 45 years. In short, his Huck Finn illustrations amounted to a Twainian turning point in Kemble's life as an artist. Twain was, in effect, authorizing a pictorial narrative which runs counter to major implications of his verbal text. For Kemble's drawings rewrite the Huck-Jim relationship by reducing Jim, whom Huck gradually recognizes as an individualized human figure, to a simple comic type. Through these portrayals, Jim is reduced to a simple comic type, a stock figure in an emerging pictorial tradition. The first snow, this is the picture of the first snow. This is the picture of the first snow. So it appeared in the issue of the Life magazine on 28th November of 1882, and it points ahead to the image of the simple, easily impressed black man that would repeatedly find its way into the pages of the Life magazine. So imagine an old black slave. A couple of his earlier generations have died out of atrocious conditions, and another generation is just beginning, which Kemble does not fail to show in the picture as well. Such a man is encompassed and is smiling heartily along with the son or the grandson that he has in front of him at the view of the first snow. Oversimplification of the Negro through these drawings, they do nothing but to undermine the historic trauma that their entire race has grown up to, that the entire race has cultivated as a culture of trauma, as a culture of a memory that is interspersed with death, memory that is interspersed with constant dehumanization. So this is what these plays, these caricatures, the tradition of the stereotyping the blacks were doing. And it was during his early years as a staff cartoonist on the Graphic that Kemble had introduced his soon to be famous drawings of the Gold Dust Twins. The Gold Dust Twins, cherubic black children who appeared in the advertisements for Fairbanks washing powder. I don't need to dwell much into this discussion, I think you are getting the hang of it. In both the cases, in both the pictures that I showed, the black figure is treated in essentially the fashion of the graphic pieces. That is a comic type bordering on caricature, features, postures exaggerated, with the result that any distinct personality and individual reality are absorbed. So there is no distinct personality or individual identity that a black slave can have. And it is absorbed into what can only be called racial abstraction. Specificities are blurred. Specific individualized identity formation is stopped, is hindered by this constant and pervasive circulation of an image that lies, of an image that takes you astray from what you actually should be seeing. And complete with a bucket, a baggy chest high pants held up by a single gallus, frayed straw hat, and look of comic indignation, Kemble's Jim is indeed the usual Negro, a repetition, in other words, of the comic stereotypes which had been appearing in the Life magazine. And in these pictures that you can see, in the early chapters of the novel, Jim is drawn repeatedly as an icon of the wide-eyed, slack-jawed astonishment, whether he is seeing what he thinks is a ghost in the first picture, approaching a cave entrance, talking with Huck. This is the cave entrance. This is talking with Huck. Or peering into the window of the House of Death. I'll give you a moment to see these pictures. Whereas on the other hand, you can see Huck's portrayals. Whenever Huck is with Jim, if you see Huck's image alone, you will never see him, adorning a hat that is other than this straw hat. But whenever he is with Jim, his hat will change and it will become better and it will become to look better. So this is because of the fact that, you know, Kemble, in order to draw Huck, actually chose a role model, actually chose a live boy and asked him to be so that he can draw him. Whereas for Jim, he did not need any life model, because of course Jim does not have any specificity. He is like that one Negro that all of the white Americans see, and they are all the same. So Kemble's typification of Jim also made it impossible for him to chart Huck's shifting perception of his friend and comrade, a perception which moves from the abstract to the concrete, from his view of Jim as a generic nigger to his recognition of Jim as an individual human being. And trapped within this comic idiom, so to speak, Kemble's Jim can only remain a static type, a pictorial reminder of the emphasis. Of comedy, images of stereotyped caricatures of black minstrels show what the recurrence of these images show, the entire tradition being absorbed into through abstraction by the nigger Jim, who is denied any individual identity. What this does is basically reinstate Mark Twain's own views, which were akin to the cultural group that he belonged to, and also his motivation to change or to shape the message for his audience, noting that the stereotypical blackface portrayals were thought to be realistic by Twain and many of his white contemporaries. The pair highlight various incidents in the pair, that is Frederick Woodard and Donnerre McCahn. I'll just put the name on a screen for you. I'm looking for this essay. If I come across it, I will definitely send it to you. But as of now, I have not been able to find it. Yes. So this pair of Woodard and McCann, they highlight various incidents in Huckleberry Finn that they think illustrate their contention that Jim plays the minstrel role to Huck's straight man. However, there will be others who will agree more to Ralph Ellison's view that Jim's character and Jim's individuality emerges from underneath the minstrel mask that has been thrust over him. Huck Finn advocates, tending to agree to Ellison's judgment, that Jim's fullness of character reveals itself. And it's a completely different reading of the novel than what this duo provides. Some view Twain's depiction of Jim early in the novel as a necessary backdrop against which Huck's gradual awareness of Jim's humanity is revealed. These early renditions of Jim serve more to lay bare Huck's initial attitudes towards race and the racial relations than they do to characterize Jim, positively or negatively. They are more inclined towards shaping the representation of Huck. And as the two fugitives ride down the Mississippi deeper and deeper into the slave's territory, the power of Jim's personality erodes and prejudices Huck's culture. And the prejudices Huck's culture has instilled, it undergoes certain kind of erosion by Jim's personality. Such readings of passages that appear to emphasize Jim's superstitions, gullibility, or foolishness allow Twain to escape the charge of racism and be seen as championing blacks by exposing the falseness of stereotypes. This view of Twain's motivation can be found in letters written to the New York Times in protest of the New York City Board Education's decision to ban the book in 1957. So look at what these people are writing in support of the book. Now, while assessing the various perspectives of the novel being racist or not, there is this one particular chapter that we can be concerned about. And that is chapter 14 or the French question. Just to summarize this chapter, this is where Huck and Jim go through the spoils that they got from the gang on the ship, on the boat of Walter Scott. Huck's excitement about their new treasure is tempered by Jim's fear that they might have been caught or drowned. After listening to Jim, Huck realizes that, as usual, Jim is right. Among the blankets, clothes and cigars, Huck finds few books and reads to Jim about romantic figures like the kings, dukes, the earls. And when the discussion turns to royalty and King Solomon, Huck and Jim debate Solomon's logic and refuse to agree on his wisdom. When the two discuss the King Solomon, Jim's practical but single-minded approach cannot convince Huck that Solomon wasn't a wise man either. Readers, however, we are, however, able to see that it is Huck and not Jim who misses the point. The real point is, as Jim says, is down further and deeper down. Statement foreshadows the debate of conscience that Huck actually undergoes, but later on in the novel. And Stephen Malloux, I will write the name of the essay. Stephen Malloux, in reading Huckleberry Finn, The Rhetoric of Performed Ideology, he comes up with quite a critically maintained theoretical post-colonial perspective of the novel and tries to trace the existence and role of what Mikhail Bakhtin introduces as a concept of colonial reading or colonial studies, Mikhail Bakhtin's concept of heteroglossia. Heteroglossia is the simultaneity of many levels of dialogue and language that exists in a novel. And since the novel is also intertextual, the fact that the novel is a genre that gives space very consciously to other works, this is intertextuality, where a novel refers to the discourse of history, literary text, culture, social contexts, which Huckleberry Finn of course does, social conditions like poverty, philosophy, theology, the class structure, the caste structure. A novel inevitably ends up doing this and thus becomes intertextual. And this intertextuality, because it exists, it is impossible to systematize the mass and variety of languages because of the sheer heterogeneity. The other's voice here, that is Jim's voice, is given as much importance as the self, which is Huck, in the novel, which then becomes a site of struggle, carnival, and subversion. Now, I used quite a few words over here. I will be aiding your understanding with a note. I am not divulging much more than this. So, using this theory of Mikhail Bakhtin's heteroglossia, which Bakhtin propounds in his book called Discourse on the Novel, he uses this theory. Stephen Malew uses the phrase called performed ideology, and his interpretation of Jim, as he appears in the philosophical debates that is in the chapter with Huck, that is the scene that he interrogates. Malew explains how a literary text can take up the ideological rhetoric of its historical moment and place it on the fictional stage. Huckleberry Finn, Malew calls, an ideological drama, and it invites readers to become spectators and actors at a rhetorical performance. In fact, the success of the ideological drama depends upon the reader's participation. The humor and often the ideological point of the novel's many arguments rely upon the reader's ability to recognize patterns of false argumentation. Within the framework of rhetorical performances, then, Jim's minstrel scenes serve as an ideological critique of white supremacy. In each case, however, the dominance of Jim's humanity over the racial discourse of white supremacy hinges upon the reader's recognition of the discrepancy between two ideologies. That how can a barbaric race, which the white superior sentiment has always tried to keep under the foot of oppression, how can it be so much inclined towards general humanity, which none of the other people lack? So it is upon the reader's ability to find which is the false, which argument is false, and how are these two arguments clashing against each other. And Malew's interpretation of the French question, it gives an example of shows that the passage entirely has nothing racist to it. Huckleberry Finn embodies what Bakhtin says regarding heteroglossia in the comic novel. The multiplicity of languages is clearly recognizable in the lower class vernacular of Huck and Pap, of course, the exaggerated slave dialect of Jim, the southern genteel tradition, the romantic diction of Scott and Dumas, as it has been gleaned by Tom and filtered through Huck and several other dialects. Both of the novels written by Twain is in concern over here. Twain himself acknowledges the painstaking attention he paid to language in the novel. Clearly, through his play with the posited author, that is Huck, the author that Twain posits as a substitute for himself, Twain's motive is to unmask and destroy various socio-ideological belief systems that are represented by language. So what Malew refers to as the rhetorical performance of Bakhtin's rhetorical performance of ideology, which I just mentioned, what Malew refers to this, Bakhtin identifies as heteroglossia struggle. Thus, Jim's successful appropriation of Huck's argumentative strategy deconstructs and destroys and dismantles the hegemony of white supremacy discourse present in Huck's language. Huck's disdainful comment, and then Huck's disdainful comment that you can't learn a nigger to argue, renders the debate little more than a literary version of minstrel dialogue, unless readers recognize the superior rhetorician. Malew writes in his essay that of course readers reject the racist slur as rationalization. They know Huck gives up because he has lost the argument. It is precisely because Jim has learned to argue by imitating Huck. Imitating Huck ta jokoni bollam tokhon arekta post colonial concept mathay asha uchit, and that is mimicry. Homi K. Bhabha's propounded theory, the mimic man, which makes the white colonizer ambivalent in nature, where the colonizer first tries to educate the other, the colonized, so that his white man's burden can be relieved, and the other is fairly educated in order to work for the white colonizer. But at the same point of time, as the process of colonization goes through and undergoes transformation for the sake of, you know, because that is what happens, it does not remain static. Rules and laws and regulations of the government change, effects change, rebellions build up, and there are more transformations and more so. So as the white man's burden compels the white colonizer to educate the other, to educate the colonized, to educate the native, to educate the black slave, in order to coerce him, in order to mold him into a more of a worker than a barbaric figure, what eventually happens through time is that the other starts to mimic the colonizer, becomes like the colonizer, and the colonizer experiences what Bhabha calls an ambivalence, wherein he fails to recognize the difference between the self and the other. His own self is at split. And this is what Malew refers to when he says that it is precisely because Jim has learned to argue by imitating Huck that he reduces his teacher to silence. Far from demonstrating Jim's inferior knowledge, the debate dramatizes his argumentative superiority, and in doing so makes a serious ideological point through a rhetoric of humor. So let us keep this particular lecture up to here, and there are a few other things that I have to say about race, and I will be, like I said in the previous class, I will be posting a few extra video lessons, and that I will be doing at my own disposal of time, of course, which I did not have as of yet. So after this class, I will be posting an extra video by tomorrow, I guess, which we will be finishing off with the discussion related to race.